Hello, multi merry-go-rounders, and thank you to Mr. Kuma J. Yes, Kuya J, beg your pardon. Just as well I write things down. Thank you to Mr. Kuya J for that malt mention, introducing Whiskey Review 388, which is us moving into a prolonged series of high-end US bourbon reviews. And our little helper today is this bottle of Four Roses single cask. Well, they call it single barrel, but single cask, same difference. Bottled at 50% alcohol, so 100 proof in US measurements. Practical little bottle, distinctive, not too fussy, and relatively informative in that it states that this single barrel has come from warehouse NN, and the serial number pertaining to the particular single barrel in this instance for your reference is 4-6D. Okie dokie. Just in case you get a similar bottle, but that's the thing about single barrel whiskies is you'll get a batch, one barrel at a time. Once it's sold out, once it disappears, you're going to get something the same but different for the simple virtue that it's coming from a different cask. Casks may look like may look the same. They may be stored in the same warehouse. They may contain the same spirit. But over time, there can be changes sufficient that that they're noticeably different in the results, and that's what makes single cask whiskies, bourbons, or whatever spirits you happen to be drinking so particularly interesting. Very much a soloist performance from single casks, rather than the orchestral performances you get from blended bourbons or blended Scotch whisky. So we've left this. Oops, there goes my. Excuse me a second. This is what I used to, my remote for switching the camera on and off. Very useful, by the way. I'm noticing immediately that this is a rich, deep quality nose. My previous review was in 387 Jim Beam Bourbon. And you really, they're both bourbons. They're both straight bourbons, but you can't get more different. You know, but to appreciate this one, you really, for all the money it's going to cost you in the first place, you really want to have a point of direct reference, and this in your basic bourbons are actually quite useful tools in that respect. They help you find your bearings and understand where the quality is at in these more expensive, more carefully presented spirits. Being bottled at 50% alcohol, I am going to add water. It will knock out some of the complexity that's therein. But I'm going to start off with it neat and give you a few wee notes on the nose. Burnt toffee. Rich corn. Interestingly, the corn cereal grain that's coming through, it seems quite rich and almost custardy, if you know what custard is. There's a certain slight egginess to it, a richness, a density, a flavour. So it really comes across initially in first nosing that they're using good quality grain, corn particular, in making this bourbon. Bear in mind that we tend to regard grains used in distillation as being one variety, and the majority of bourbon and corn based spirits are made with a very restricted variety of corns. It is basically the current modified engineered corn that tends to be used because it's cheapest to source. And it's worth pointing out at this stage that I have noticed in several sources online that Four Roses, although it would be perfectly legal for them to be using genetically modified corn, they choose not to do so as a company policy, and I certainly commend them for that if that is the case. Although there tends to be a kind of polarized opinion about genetically modified corn, which is used for the production of bourbon generally, because rose growers in domestic gardens have been genetically modifying their roses over the years to get the variety of colours that we enjoy in hybrid tea and floribundas. Yes. In fact, there are hobbyists across the United States, America, and back garages who are in genetic modification clubs, who are basically fiddling about with genetics because it's relatively easy to do so. I think that one of the problem, and I'm just kind of addressing the genetic modification corn thing here while we're talking about Four Roses, for the simple reason that, as far as I'm aware, they're not using genetically modified corn. It tends to be quite a polarized hot issue in that genetic modification is automatically bad. But what I would suggest is, in fact, if it is done carefully and for the right reasons, i.e. for the improved yield of a grain, but also for the durability in times of bad harvest, for the nutritional enrichment of the grain, that's good genetic modification. But when it's done purely for overt commercial grain gain and brand monopoly, then that's not so hot. If you want to know more, read up on Monsanto. Back to bourbon. On the nose, I started off with the burnt toffee, corn, molasses, a touch of ginger, peach, maple, candied peel of fruit, cranberry, melon, mild spearmint, so a touch of mintiness here, quite complex in the nose really, vanilla, clove rock, and cinnamon, and some caramel, natural nose of caramel. You will notice when it comes to bourbons that two repeating predominant flavour notes are both cinnamon and, to a certain extent, a milder extent, clove. They tend to go hand in hand along with the wood spice. Funnily enough, this is becoming, with as the tannins from the cask are exerting themselves in the spirit, it's becoming a little drier and more naturally complex. There's a certain savoury note creeping in now in the nose. When a spirit is bottled at a higher strength, of course, there's more alcohol involved in making up the proportion of the bottle. Therefore, there's more opportunity for flavour to be held. That's the benefit of cask strength stuff. Higher strength means the opportunity to hold more flavour. Taste wise, spirity, of course it is. It's 50% alcohol. In with some water now. I won't add much to start with because I can always add more later, but one more spoon will do for now. Very rich flavour. Sweet citrus. As soon as you add water, the tannins, the dryness gets knocked back, and you get this complex sweet citrus note. Lemongrass in particular. Lime juice, certainly. Lime juice, by the way, is another flavour note which crops up repeatedly in bourbons. Sharp candy spice. Corn, wheat, lemongrass, maple, vanilla, honey, cola cubes, pineapple jam. Now, there's an interesting one for a bourbon. Melon, cinnamon, rose flowers, rose otto, rose water. A slight Turkish delight note. And with the water comes quite an interesting prolonged development, and this is what really starts to make this a standout single cask bourbon. And this particular one cost me about £40 in the UK, so that for the terms of quality, bang for your buck, so to speak, you know, this really is a good place to start. In the finish, toasted bread, cinnamon dust, honey, and mild oak wood. Interesting how the floral and the slight confectionery note has overtaken the citrus, since even the last taste, the citrus element has subsided and it's been overtaken. So this is quite an evolving spirit in the glass. It's spirits like these, by the way, that establish and hold America's, well, bourbon's reputation as a premium spirit, as a matured spirit. And it's quite an important sector, the single cask, small batch, for the producers, because people, as is the cultural habit, tend to mix and cocktailize standard bourbons. They're not really drunk straight unless they're on the rocks, but in terms of slow sipping and a lot of kind of engagement in search of flavor and quality of nose, it's the reputation of bourbon is held by the single cask and by the small batch variations. And notice the price is creeping up on them, by the way, because they are becoming more popular as people who are particularly familiar with Scotch are looking to diversify their palate and diversify their experience with spirits. And bourbons tend to go hand in hand with rum as being appropriate options for your Scotch whisky drinker. Any other comments on Four Roses before I sign off? Yeah. And interesting, they have two grain. They mention in their, I'm doing my online research as I tend to do, although not too much because I don't want to get too bogged down in statistics. But they tend to have two grain varieties when they're producing at Four Roses. And interestingly, they're using different yeast varieties, which is something that doesn't happen with Scotch whiskies. So that's another interesting aspect to note about Four Roses. I've tasted a few of the bourbons, small batch primarily, and the single cask before, and I've always been a fan of what they do. I tend to like the style production, and the fact that I've recently discovered that they're using, are claiming to use, five different yeast varieties. And bear in mind that in Scotch whisky, it's predominantly one yeast variety is used. But you have the yeast family is a big family, and beer producers around the world are quite familiar with using different yeast varieties to get different characteristics in the result. But here we have it happening in bourbon production, and that to me is interesting. Well-crafted and harmonious bourbon at an affordable price. Having said that, I've noticed some fresh, similar bottle shape, cask variations of Four Roses come out, and they're a lot more expensive. So buy while you can, malt mates. The price is a good liquor. It only goes up. Marks out of 100. Here it is. 89. Out of 100, and that's a bourbon mark. There you go. My final conclusions in this particular bourbon is, over time, there's quite a lot of activity in terms of both the nose and the taste, and that's what really brings me to give it this particular mark. And I think an intrinsic part of the range in the delivery of this bourbon is to actually do with the quality, the raw quality of the ingredients being used. And I do get the impression that the people in charge of Four Roses are very much aware of the relevance of quality ingredients. You know, it's the old saying, guy go garbage in, garbage out. Well, here we've got quaiquo, quality in, quality out. There you go. I hope you'll join me again for Whiskey Review 389, when we will be moving on to our next bottle, which is this Birnheim Wheat Whiskey. Now, there's not a lot of wheat whiskies around, so that's going to be an interesting one. I hope you'll join me again for our journey, our pioneering migration through the world of American bourbons and related whiskies. I've got my fancy map up in the wall. I haven't really used it as much yet, although Four Roses comes from, where does it come from? Is Bardstown, is it? I should have brought my glasses out. Anyway, it's around about there. That is the Frankfurt and Bardstown. They're the big bourbon bases of Kentucky. Right, enough said for the moment. Don't want to overdo this. Join me shortly when we'll be on to a wheat whiskey review. That'll be interesting because there's not a lot of wheat whiskies out there. There's personally, I think there's reasons for that, but join me again and we will explore that bottle.